Shalom, dalam VOP kali ini kita akan membahas Pentecost again. Dalam 2 Raja-Raja 4 ayat 1 sampai 6, kita membaca sebuah peristiwa mengenai wanita janda dari seorang nabi. Wanita tersebut mengutarakan kondisinya kepada Elisa, di mana ia dikejar-kejar oleh penagih hutang dan anaknya terancam untuk diambil sebagai budak. Peristiwa ini dapat dimaknai secara rohani sebagai gambaran gereja di masa kini. Janda yang ditinggal suami yang berhutang dapat dianalogikan sebagai gereja yang merasa ditinggalkan Tuhan sebagai yatim piatu di dunia ini, yaitu orphan spirit yang ada di dalam gereja. Penagih hutang dalam konteks ini dapat menjadi sebuah tipologi atau kiasan dari iblis yang selalu berusaha menggocoh dan menuntut hutang darah. Namun, perlu dipahami bahwa hal ini tentu tidak berarti bahwa profesi debt collector dapat diasosiasikan dengan iblis. Sementara itu, situasi yang dihadapi oleh wanita janda ini juga dapat menggambarkan kondisi yang menekan gereja hari-hari ini. Tekanan ini dapat muncul saat gereja lengah, tidak berjaga-jaga, atau membuka celah bagi iblis untuk mengintervensinya. Celah ini digambarkan dengan baik oleh jerat hutang dari suaminya yang adalah seorang nabi. Padahal, orang yang takut akan Allah tentu akan senantiasa mengandalkannya dan tidak akan jatuh pada jerat hutang piutang yang tidak dapat dibayarkannya sesuai waktu yang ditentukan. Uniknya, kondisi ini tidak hanya berdampak pada sang istri nabi, tetapi juga dapat berdampak pada generasi muda, yaitu anak-anak mereka. Kondisi tanpa ayah ini membuat anak-anak janda itu kehilangan tudung rohani. Tidak ada lagi figur bapak yang mengayomi dan menjamin masa depan mereka. Anak-anak janda ini menjadi generasi yang terhilang dan warisan panggilan dari ayahnya pun tidak dapat dilanjutkan. Di tengah kondisi yang sulit itu, sang wanita janda mencari pertolongan hamba Tuhan, yaitu Nabi Elisa. Elisa mengingatkan keluarga itu bahwa mereka belum kehilangan segalanya. Masih ada harapan, sebab masih ada minyak yang disimpan dalam buli-buli di rumah mereka. Minyak di dalam konteks gereja Tuhan dimaknai sebagai urapan dari Roh Kudus. Sisa dari urapan itu dapat menyelamatkan gereja Tuhan dari kondisi yang sulit. Namun, jumlah minyak sedikit tidaklah cukup untuk membawa keluarga ini sebagai tipologi gereja Tuhan, untuk lepas dari intimidasi si penagih hutang. Seperti yang diceritakan di dalam kisah ini, diperlukan minyak yang berlimpah. Perlu pengurapan Roh Kudus dengan kapasitas yang besar dan luar biasa. Untuk memperoleh urapan Roh Kudus itu, kita sebagai gereja Tuhan perlu untuk mendengarkan pesan Tuhan lewat hambanya dan taat melakukan perintah Tuhan itu. Dalam konteks cerita ini ada dua hal yang harus kita lakukan. Yang pertama adalah pemulihan hubungan antar generasi, antar ibu dan anak. Perlu adanya kerjasama antara generasi muda dengan generasi yang lebih tua dalam menghadapi kondisi sulit yang dipicu oleh penagih hutang ini. Perlu ada arahan visioner dan relevan dari generasi orang tua bagi anak-anak mereka. Di sisi lain, perlu adanya kepercayaan dan ketaatan dari generasi muda untuk menjalankan visi yang mereka terima. Generasi orang tua dan generasi anak muda harus bersinergi, mengambil beban yang sama. Dan yang kedua, menyiapkan bejana-bejana dan menuangkan minyak. Artinya gereja Tuhan perlu mempersiapkan hati yang haus dan lapar akan pengurapan Roh Kudus. Sehingga Roh Kudus dapat dilimpahkan dengan dahsyat dan bejana hati kita tidak akan kering atau kekurangan minyak lagi. Melihat tantangan yang dihadapi oleh gereja Tuhan hari-hari ini, mutlak perlu adanya pencurahan Roh Kudus yang dahsyat. Sebagai keluarga besar GBI Gatsu, kita tentu dapat sepakat bahwa Pentakosta ketigalah yang akan menjadi jawaban bagi keringnya bejana hati gereja Tuhan di zaman akhir ini. Kita membutuhkan Pentakosta yang baru atau Pentecost again supaya urapan Roh Kudus tetap dapat berlimpah-limpah di tengah tuntutan dan intimidasi dari iblis yang semakin kuat di era ini. Jadi, mari sama-sama terus membangun relasi intergenerasi yang baik dan terus memiliki hati yang haus dan lapar supaya lawatan Roh Kudus di era Pentakosta ketiga segera digenapi dan bejana hati kita tidak akan pernah kekurangan minyak lagi. Untuk penjelasan lebih lengkap dari tim teologi kami, silakan klik link yang ada di atas atau scan QR code yang tersedia. Tuhan Yesus memberkati.
Mari kita sama-sama membaca firman Tuhan dari Mazmur 91. Dalam lindungan Allah. Orang yang duduk dalam lindungan yang Maha Tinggi dan bermalam dalam naungan yang Maha Kuasa
akan berkata kepada Tuhan, tempat perlindunganku dan kubu pertahananku, Allahku yang kupercayai.
Sungguh, Dialah yang akan melepaskan engkau dari jerat penangkap burung, dari penyakit sampar yang busuk.
Dengan ketpaknya ia akan menudungi engkau. Di bawah sayapnya engkau akan berlindung. Kesetiaannya ialah perisai dan pagar tembok.
Engkau tak usah takut terhadap kedahsyatan malam, terhadap panah yang terbang di waktu siang,
terhadap penyakit sampar yang berjalan di dalam gelap, terhadap penyakit menular yang mengamuk di waktu petang.
Walau 1000 orang rebah di sisimu dan 10.000 di sebelah kananmu, tetapi itu tidak akan menimpamu.
Engkau hanya menontonnya dengan matamu sendiri dan melihat pembalasan terhadap orang-orang fasik.
Sebab Tuhan ialah tempat perlindunganmu. Yang Maha Tinggi telah kau buat tempat perteduhanmu.
Malapetaka tidak akan menimpa kamu, dan tula tidak akan mendekat kepada kemahmu.
Sebab malaikat-malaikatnya akan diperintahkannya kepadamu untuk menjaga engkau di segala jalanmu.
Mereka akan menatang engkau di atas tangannya, supaya kakimu jangan terantuk kepada batu.
Singa dan ular tedung akan kau langkahi, engkau akan menginjak anak singa dan ular naga.
Sungguh hatinya melekat kepadaku, maka aku akan meluputkannya. Aku akan membentenginya, sebab ia mengenal namaku.
Bila ia berseru kepadaku, aku akan menjawab. Aku akan menyertai dia dalam kesesakan. Aku akan meluputkannya dan memuliakannya.
Dengan panjang umur akan kukenyangkan dia, dan akan kuperlihatkan kepadanya keselamatan daripadaku.
Mari kita terus berdoa untuk Pentakosta ketiga. Pentakosta ketiga adalah pencurahan Roh Kudus yang dahsyat di zaman ini, melebihi yang terjadi di Azusa Street. Pentakosta ketiga akan mengakibatkan penuaian jiwa yang terbesar dan yang terakhir sebelum Tuhan Yesus datang kembali. Pentakosta ketiga akan membangkitkan generasi Yeremia, yaitu anak-anak muda yang dipenuhi Roh Kudus, cinta mati-matian kepada Tuhan Yesus, tidak kompromi terhadap dosa, dan akan bergerak untuk memenangkan jiwa. Pentakosta ketiga lahir di Indonesia dan bergerak ke bangsa-bangsa. Gerakan ini dari timur ke barat dan akan kembali ke Yerusalem. Pentakosta ketiga akan memberikan kuasa untuk menyelesaikan amanat agung, dan setelah itu Tuhan Yesus datang kembali. Amin.
Shalom everyone, welcome to BCC online Sunday service. We are glad that you all join us this morning to celebrate God's goodness in our life. Let's bow down and pray. We thank you, Abba Father, for all of the goodness and for all your plan to our life. For all those things, Lord, we want to give you glory, praise, and honor only to you, Jesus. We want to celebrate your goodness. We want to remind ourselves of what you have done in our life. We thank you, Lord, for your love never runs out from our life. Thank you, Jesus. We are ready to serve you. We are ready to praise you. We are ready to worship you, God. Be with us, and Holy Spirit, you are in here with us. Bring the joy in here, Lord. And we are waiting for your presence, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
Pray.
for the joy. We thank you, Lord, that you are in us. You are big in us. You are the power. You are the miracle. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. We want to surrender all to you, Jesus. Lead us and have your way. Thank you.
There is no one love us like you do, Jesus.
you. We need you. We need your presence. We need your words. We pray to you, Jesus. Come and fill our life again, Lord. Because we need you. In everything we do, please lead us and have your way and let your will be done in our life, not ours. We want to surrender to you, Jesus. Take all of me and be the Lord in our life. You are the power, all the glory, all the praises, all the honor is belong to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you.
Father God in heaven, we are so grateful for this morning. Thank you, presence of God, Lord Jesus. You can bless us, Lord Jesus. It's one of us, wherever we are. Lord, bless us, especially to this morning. Lord, open our hearts, our mind, Lord. May this word of God will bless us with opened our mind. Speak to us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We pray, amen and amen. Shalom, brothers. So wherever you are, I hope that you enjoy in praise and worship. Amen. So this is the time for us to receive the words of God. Just prepare our hearts, our mind. Amen. This morning, I want to continue the sermon for the second session for the sermons. The first part is on March 13. You can watch in YouTube, verse 13. And the title is Foundations. So how the foundation is so important for us, even though for the small building or the high-rise building, all the buildings need foundations. So in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 25, is talking about the soil itself, the soil. I explain detail on March 13, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, is not the soil, but it's more to the foundation itself, but it depends on the soil. So be careful how to build the foundation based on the soil. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, is the type of the foundations. But here give the two example at that time. One example is the Ersin City. Ersin City in Turkey. Ersin, the city of Ersin is the breaking news. It shocked a lot of people, especially for the Turkey government. Why? Because the Ersin City, if you see the building in the other city, almost 25,000 buildings destroyed by the earthquake, but the Ersin is there's no building destroyed. And because of the, and even so that the Ersin is, the location of Ersin is like almost the, in the epicenter of the earthquake, but survive. Why this is so important for the government? Because of this, they capture, they detain 10 people and almost investigate a couple hundreds, more than 100 people. I explained that in March 12. Okay, now we want to continue the second part of the foundations. So go back with the 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12. This is Apostle Saul, Apostle Paul said that if anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw. So the Apostle Paul said that only six categories for the foundations. So all the believers, based on this, the foundation, our foundation is based on which one of these. But the things is we don't know which one ours. That the things, right? But for example, I give you this. This is an example. We don't know which one ours. For example, if I told you one of this, either gold or silver or stones or wood or hay or straw in this box, how can we know? We don't know that's our faith based on gold, silver, stone, wood, hay, or straw. The Paul said like this in 13 that their work will be shown what it is, because of the day we will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. So the only way we know the quality, the only way we know is by through the fire. With the fire, we'll test the quality. Only fire can test. So if I say that in this box, there will be either either the gold, silver, stone, or straw, or wood, how can you know about this? You can burn this. If gold or silver or stone will survive through the fire, but if inside is wood or hay or straw, no, there's no cannot survive. So in other words, yes, there are two big groups, categories, whether that gold, silver, stone, whether that can survive through fires or cannot survive. That's the test means for us. Just like a foundation, just like our faith, is we have to be prepared to let God test us so we know what is our foundation. So this morning, I want to show you how God tests me about this with my testimony. Okay, here, as we all know, explained last time, so that this is the building. I involved this with this building in Kemayoran, and I involved in this building since beginning. From the scratch and the design, and then built with construction, but not finished, around in this floor, okay? About 10 or 15 floors in the construction, I stopped. Why I stopped? I want to explain about this. And personally asked me in the beginning, when I worked there, Pastor Rene asked me, "How is your work? How is work? How is your work?" So I always said, "I like it so much, like it, because Yes, the team is not big, small team, but it's solid. We have a good relationship with each other. Even for when we have lunch, we have big table in the middle of the office. We always have lunch together. We talk each other, joke around something. It's just like a family. I like it so because our relationship is so close to each other. So yeah, that's the moment. Okay. Until one day, the afternoon, I got the letter from my general manager. So one the general manager all only put in the note on the table. It's one of every one of us have the memorandum from our general manager there. He said that in the late afternoon before we go home, he said that. From next month, we have to work on Sunday. We have to work on Sunday. I don't know why he did that. And because after that, totally different atmosphere in the office. Usually, we are on the one floor, so our GM is in the other in the corner. So he always open the window, open the doors, so we can see him, we can talk to him, open. But since then, he always close the window, close the door. We even hardly talk with him after this. I find out later on that actually he has niece. The niece also an architect, just graduate from the school. So he planned he want that his niece to work as an architect in this project. So there's only one way to work in this project. So get rid of me. Remove me from the office. I found out later on, but I found out it's so weird that totally after that memo, the atmosphere is so different. So when person asked me, "No, how is your?" Totally, I don't like it at all. I don't like it at all. Every morning, when I go to the office is so with burden, so burden. Okay, why this is problem for us? I just want to give you the heads up, the what kind of life our life at that moment. Okay, in our life, our daily or our Sunday, every Sunday, what is the activity every Sunday? Okay, we were involved in ministry, well, in music department, musicians and personally also singer and worship leader. Okay, we've been involved there for about 4 or 5 years already. By years and years, the activity every Sunday, mostly like we have usually we ministry 2 or 3, but mostly it's 3 services. Says in the morning, and also 2 or 1 service in the afternoon, in all over the places all around Jakarta and other of outside of Jakarta. So that's our weekly, every Sunday we ministry. So in the morning, for example, just for most of them is from 7. Some of them is 6 o'clock in the morning. So if 7 o'clock, I have to be there 6:30. If I have to be there 6:30, it means that I have to get out from the house. It's 5:30 in the morning, so I have to get up 4:30. This day, so every Sunday, years by years. Okay, so after 2 or 3 services, so in the middle, sometimes we have to get rest to force ourselves to sleep. If, especially in GCC, if Pastor Nico preaching, so we have to we have to force ourselves to sleep. Why? Because if we ministry five services at that moment, every service we have to stay in the especially us as musicians have to be ready. Whenever Pastor Nico want to sing, we have to be ready. So if five services, we have to stay in worship leader and sermon. It's very take a lot of energy. I remember a couple times if we don't force us to sleep on the after five services, it's just like vegetable. I cannot think anymore. It's just like robot. Okay. So if we in the other place, it's better. But most likely we have two or one service in the afternoon. So when I said to the general manager, said, "I'm sorry, I have to ministry on Sunday," he said that, "Okay, in between you can go to work." So, in other words, in every two Sunday, I have to work and ministry. Can you imagine what kind of life that we had at that moment? So sometimes when I work, personally sleep in the car and have to go ministry again in the afternoon. That's every Sunday, not every week. That's the kind of life. But we did it anyway. There's no way we can avoid this. It's hard. It's so tiring. It's a lot of energy. But we did it anyway, month after month after month. But this is the soft test. So after months and months and months, another memo from general manager. The general manager suddenly put another note for all of us. He said that starting 2 weeks after this, which is another next month, is one of us, manager and up, have to stay in the office until 7 o'clock every other day. Our office is from 8 or 9 until 7 o'clock. Can you imagine? Okay, why this is a problem for me? Again, now I want to give you what kind of life, our life in daily basis, which is from Monday to Saturday. Here, our daily basis. I was involved at least about six departments, to lead six departments, at least, approximately. For example, on Sunday, I was coordinator for the service, inborn service, the third one. The second, also involved in music department in the head office, church head. So it means that I can ministry in the around Jakarta or outside Jakarta, like Tangerang, Bekasi, Kerawang, something like that. So all around. But not only that, I was also involved in Kelapa Gading itself, in the region Kelapa Gading, as a music department, head music department. So I have to schedule all the branch, the region in Kelapa Gading, so Kelapa Gading, Tanjung Priok, and that area. So because I involved in Kelapa Gading, so a lot of activity, so workers' prayers and another meeting in Kelapa Gading. But also in Kelapa Gading, I was a head of young adult, dewasa muda. And because of the head, young adults, also a prayer meeting for young adult itself, and that's the daily basis. For Friday and Saturday, we go. Usually, we go from one party to the other party. Friday and Saturday,
What kind of party? Wedding party. Why? Because I was also the head of the department in Kanamon Sikh Ministry. Kanamon Sikh Ministry is in to minister specifically for the workers in the churches from Pastor Nico, especially in Jakarta, around Jakarta. All the workers, if they want have ministry like for the musician, singer, and MC, I have to schedule them. So small team, but really skillful keyboard player, skillful bassist, skillful drummer, solo guitarist, violin, saxophone. Small team, but really skillful. For example, one of the team, I remember that one of the keyboards in NDC, Joseph Jaffer, that's why in my team at the moment. So, yeah. So it, that's kind of quality in the team, Kana Music Ministry. Because small team, so I also sometimes involved in that, help them. So sometimes one wedding in one day, sometimes Saturday, we can go to two weddings at the moment. That's the daily, every Saturday, every Friday. Can you imagine? That's the our daily basis from Sunday to Saturday, from Monday to Saturday. Now, the things is, if I have to stay in the office until 7 o'clock, that's really, I don't know how to combine that. So we have 2 weeks for that decision. So we were fasting, we pray for that. We have 2 weeks. I don't know the solution with this. Really don't know. So after we were fasting at the second week, at the end of second week, we met Pastor Pak Chris Manusama. Pak Chris Manusama. And I remember that when he prayed for me, he lay his hand on me, he said like this, here, God will honor you because you honor God. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 38, those who honor me, I will honor. When I, at the moment, my tears were dropped, I know what the meaning by it is. It's so simple, so simple. The one question is, if you work in that company, will you be able to ministry again? The answer is simple, no. For sure that I cannot ministry if I still work in that company. So in this case, not plus, but more to or. Whether ministry or work, I choose ministry. I choose ministry. That's why I know what God wants me. This is not easy for us because I have installment, car installment to pay. I need this job. I need the money to pay our to live. I don't know how to fulfill our needs because if I quit this job, it's not the easiest decision. Now, this is the test for me. It's just like a fire for me. It's not a simple decision. This is really big decision for us. So the next morning, Monday, I meet with my director, say to them, so give the resigned letter. And what my director said to me, said, I honor you, whatever decision, That's my confirmation that I have to quit this job. So the questions, when I share this, when I prepare this, Holy Spirit speak to me. And what do you think? Why does God sometimes do this to you or to others? Sometimes God allow these situations like on fire. Is it just because God wants you to suffer miserable life? Is that God wants you to be? Actually, no. The simple example, for example, if the right time for the baby to eat the food, not the baby food, so what will the parents do to the baby? They will test to give the baby the food, right? The real food, not the baby food. Give him test whether that the baby can receive or not. The other example, if the time for the baby to walk, what the parents will do to the baby? The parents will test the baby, let him walk, whether that the baby can walk or not. We'll test them. The questions, why the parents do that to the baby? Is it because want to harm the baby, to make the baby miserable, suffer? No, it's because the parents love and care the baby. He wants baby grow, to know whether that baby is grow or not. That the test for, because the parents care to the baby. If the parents doesn't care the baby, doesn't care whether that baby can walk or not, doesn't care whether the baby eat or not, it's just the meaning that the parents doesn't love the baby. Because God loves me. He, in certain life of our life, God tested me. That's what the test all about in our life. Because God loved me, certain time, or I have to grow in this certain time. So one thing, that when I honor God, God knows that He showed me something that's unthinkable. Psalm 91 verse 15. He shall call upon me, I will answer me, I will be with him in trouble, I will be delivered him, honor him. I always change to God, he and you to me. I shall call upon him and he will answer me. He will be with me in trouble, he will deliver me and honor me. That I always speak every day, every morning. When honor, look, he will be with me in trouble and deliver me. God specifically show me this through this process. First of all, short story that the project stuck for a lot of reasons stuck. So all the workers there, all the staff there, they have memorandum that they cannot quit the job until the building is finished. Cannot quit. I don't know how long, but they stuck in that project. Even the project is stuck. First, and the general manager, for some reason, after that, not long after that, discovers corrupted. Not only that, that it's exposed not only to the management, but also to the construction workers, like a kuli-kuli bangunan. Construction workers from the top to the lowest. So whenever he walked in the to the project, the workers know that, oh, he's been corrupted. Can you imagine how humiliated, how embarrassed for him to walk in that project? But not only that, the architect consultant that we use at the moment, because of this project, he moved to new places. He moved to the new place, the bigger place, better place, new area. So when they moved to that building, new building, one month after they caught on fire, the building destroy everything. Not only that, again, the contractor. The contractor, we use the number top three contractor in Indonesia. Top three contractor. And because the projects are stuck, because of that, the contractor filed bankruptcy. And there is no more this name contractor in Jakarta because of this project. The last thing that even worse, one day before Lebaran, the workers burned down the office. Previous my office, all the drawing, all the things burned down, finished. So when I talk with them after a couple months, all of them said to me, "Billy, you are so lucky. You are so lucky." But I said to him, "It's not lucky. Because God loves me. When God tests me, I pass the test. And God honor me. He protected me, deliver me from any old troubles. That because God honor me, because I honor God. If you pass the test, God will honor you. Amen." So the test is for our goodness. The purpose is not for others. It's for me, ourselves, to grow. Amen. I hope these two parts of the foundations will give you picture, enlighten you, open your mind, will encourage you. Each one of you is different compared to me. It's differently, of course, but still, the test is good for us to grow. Amen. I invite everybody to bow our head. Jesus, thank you, Lord Jesus, for the two series of the foundations. We know now about the foundations. We know about the test. That's for me, for our growth. Lord, help us to know, strengthen us. Give us, Lord Jesus, understanding for all this, Lord Jesus. Lord, help us, give us wisdom. Let us pass the test from you for us, Lord Jesus. Lord, thank you for your love, your cares for us. Thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you, Lord. Lord, bless us, Israel, one of us, our families. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this morning. Bless us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. and amen. God bless you.
Shalom and happy Sunday, everyone. Welcome to our church, Bethel Church, California. I'm so glad to see all of you here with us either on site or virtually. All right, let's hear some announcements for this week.
Our on-site Sunday service will be on every Sunday at 5 p.m. and it will be served in Bahasa Indonesia. If you do come at our on-site Sunday service, please note that there is no Sunday school provided at this time. And if you bring your child, please make sure that they stay with you at all times. However, for our online service, we will continue to have online service every Sunday at 11 a.m. in English and 5 p.m. in Bahasa Indonesia.
We encourage everyone to join our Azusa Street Prayer Tower that is available 24 hours and 7 days a week. Our church BCC will host on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. If you're interested to join, please use the meeting ID and password on the screen.
Our church would like to thank all of you for those of you who have been giving to our church generously. Thank you so very much. If you have been blessed today, there are three ways to give. Firstly, you may give through PushPay. Simply text BCCSF to a number 1-833-285-1500 and follow the instructions provided. You may also give through Zelle to bccsf.finance@gmail.com. And lastly, you may send a check to our address, BCC, California, 120 Old County Road, Brisbane, California, 94005. For more information on all of our church's events and activity, please visit our social media page on Facebook. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. That is all for our announcements. Happy Sunday and God bless.
Let us close today's service with a prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your presence and your guidance in our lives every day. We thank you for your blessings and protection in our lives, that we are all able to be here and worship and listen to you. We thank you for today's message, Lord. We pray for all of us who listens, that your words will always be the guide and the light in our lives. And we pray for your favor in whatever we do in our lives. Whatever we do in our schools, our office and businesses, that we will always be successful and we will always be blessings to everybody around us. We pray for our leader pastors, Pastor Billy and Pastor Sonny, and their daughter Abigail. May you bless this family, Lord, and you bless their ministry even more. That you continue to give them the wisdom to lead BCC and everybody closer to your kingdom. We pray for your continuous protection, for health, for blessing and joy upon these family, Lord. And we hope that their ministry will always be multiplied in your favor and will continue to be blessing and light for the community. Lord, I also want to pray for our senior pastor, Pastor Nico, and his ministry. We ask for your guidance and anointment, Lord. We pray for you to grant him your Holy Spirit and give him the strength and the vision for the church and continue to bring blessings upon more people in the world. Thank you so much, Lord. We also want to pray for the two countries, the United States and Indonesia. We pray for the leaders in these two countries, President Biden and President Jokowi. We pray for their hearts and that you give them the wisdom to make the right decisions and bring blessings to the people and to the citizens and to the world. We pray for the government of these two countries, Lord, to be fearful of you, and we pray for you to work through them, and may all the work that they're done will be done according to your will. Thank you so much, Lord Jesus. again for all of your grace and goodness. And now, as we close today's service, please help us prepare our hearts to receive the benediction.
I invite everybody to raise our hand to receive benediction. May the blessing from God the Father in His Son Jesus Christ and fellowship with the Holy Spirit will always be with us for now and until Maranatha, the second coming of Jesus Christ, and until forever and ever. Those who believe that, say together with me, Amen and Amen. Have a blessed Sunday. God bless you.